everything that we're going to talk about for the next couple of minutes is on a position description in your packet and is designed to be able to be interfaced with Volunteer Match. So everybody root right now and get out your position description from your packet. So you're going to be designing, as we've heard, many position descriptions over time. But this is the model that we use with all of our clients, again, available for you to use as an interactive fillable PDF on the website, which actually is Volunteer Match's website. So before we talk about the elements of position descriptions, I want to talk about roles. Because in the world of traditional volunteer management, we have a person, a job, at a time. And that model's sort of going out the door. So we want to give you some things to think about of other kinds of roles for volunteers beyond a person, a job. So you already heard me push back about that model of a person and a job that's huge isn't going to work anymore with this new generation. So we need to think strategically about how we approach our job. So one is seasonal. We have a season. We know that library utilization goes way up in the summertime. So we're going to staff up for that. Volunteers sometimes have a season. In my community, we have a phenomenon called snowbirds. You don't have that in California. But snowbirds go to Phoenix in the wintertime. So we want to think beyond our seasons into volunteer seasons and think about ways to engage volunteers who aren't necessarily in our place. So a person can be a volunteer in Phoenix. They can be a mentor, they can be a coach, they might even be able to be a project manager, a researcher. So we're not talking about the place always being our place. Could be their place, could be midnight, could be winter, summer, fall. The next one is substitute. This is really my favorite one because substitute allows us to be really flexible about people's schedule and meeting people where they're at. So if you have volunteers like Ann Hilda who've been doing it forever, and they're really ready to sort of leave, but they don't want to totally leave, they're great substitutes. So great. Hilda, would you give us 1 month a year where you're available on what days and what times? So substitutes give us a great deal of flexibility. It's a way of keeping people close to us who are ready to sort of downshift. And it's a way for us to have more continuity. Job sharing. So we all know what job sharing is, and I believe very strongly that in a, particularly a committee structure, there should always be a chair who mentors a co-chair, who then becomes the chair, who mentors a co-chair, and it goes on and on. Now, I just want to give you a little bit of language. If I were queen of the world, and oh, I would be so good at it, I would get rid of the word committee. Because when you hear committee, what do you think of? Work? Boring meetings. I call that death by meeting. And is there an end to committees? Never. They go on forever. They're a life sentence. When I say to you the word team, what do you think of?
Energy.
Energy. What else? Collaboration. What else?
Equality.
Equality. What else? Oh, I'm sorry?
Lakers.
Okay, good. What? And Nuggets, excuse me. And what else?
Results.
Fun, fast moving. So it turns out that how we describe things really matters. And when we use language that's antiquated for boomers and the generations that follow them, we have already lost them. So job sharing, we tend to think of two teachers who share a class or two volunteer coordinators who share a job. And we think we're looking for similar skills, similar people. What I want to suggest to you is 2 + 2 = 5. And in the world in which you take people who can work together with complementary skills, you get even more. So job sharing, whether it's leading or doing, is an underutilized resource for volunteers. Again, we're looking at volunteers who move and travel. When we get beyond one person, we work more on sustainability. So I used to say when I started as a volunteer director, if it feels too big, it is too big. So as you see that job and it feels too big, it is too big. Nobody's going to want to do it. So by taking it down to you're sharing those responsibilities is better. There is a phenomenon across the United States that I see as I travel, which is I will be on the committee, but don't ask me to be chair. You're seeing this in your churches, your synagogues, your friends groups. It's because we've made the chair an unbelievably untenable, too big a job. So if we say it's going to be a job share, and there's actually going to be four people, two job sharing chairs to two job sharing co-chairs, that feels more manageable. So job sharing can be a great way of involving more people, making it more fun and having more sustainable results. Rotation just says that I can rotate in and out, that I have, again, the more flexibility I have, the more choice I have, the better. Marlene Wilson, who is like the godmother of all volunteer management, she wrote a book on it in 1976, happens to be from Boulder, Colorado. She says the job of the volunteer engagement professional, she called it volunteer manager, is to protect the freedom of choice for the volunteer. Isn't that gorgeous? That our job becomes not just our investment in our future, our thrivinghood, our survivalhood, but also in celebrating their choice to be with us, their choice to share their skills, and so that they can rotate in and out of jobs, that they have choice about when and how they work, that they can actually take a sabbatical of their choice, so they're not signing up for a life sentence. Segmentation says if the job feels too big, it is. So I'm a cook. I love to cook. But I will let you know that if there are more than six ingredients in the recipe, I go to the next page. Right? So if it feels like too much, I'm not going to do it. If it feels like it's six or less, my favorite book is The Four Ingredient Meal, right? You just need spices and you have dinner. Then I'm going to do it. So you really want to think about if it feels too big, it is too big. And I'm going to give you some ideas about how to make that better in a minute. Team volunteering, we've already talked about. And then, of course, virtual. I can volunteer from anywhere. I can help in any way. Research, coaching, mentoring, etc. So we've talked long and hard today about what it means for you to build your personal capacity. Remember, if every single one of us got a capacity-building volunteer, the worlds in our libraries would change quicker than if we don't. And so I want to propose to you three new ways of engaging volunteers that may never have occurred to you. One is a consultant. There's a data deficit, an information deficit, a skill deficit in your library that you can engage a skilled person to come help you with. So, for example, I've been advising a lot of my clients who are nonprofits who have no human resource professional and who are now having to lay people off, that they could get volunteers who are HR directors in corporations who have, frankly, a lot more experience about layoffs to come in and work with the staff. So they would come in and consult over a particular skill for a period of time. The second one is coach, and I don't mean soccer or basketball. What I do mean is that I agree to coach you around a specific subject where I have expertise and you don't. So there's turning the world on its ear. As staff do it till you die, we're expected to know everything all the time. This is saying, I could really use some help learning about HR. I could use some help learning to be a better engager of people. I could use some help learning how to be a better financial manager, whatever it is, and I'm going to get a coach. What's beautiful about a coach is that you can say to them, will you help me for 15 hours over 5 months? You get to pick the hour. You get to pick the time. This would be really helpful to me. I have been a coach for 2 years for the volunteer director of the Jewish Family Service of Denver. She's somebody I knew socially, but not very well. I went to a volunteer fair, and she had just started as a volunteer director, and she was staffing the booth, and she looked like this. So I said, Nancy, you got a new job. And she goes, yeah. And I go, how's it going? It's horrible. I'm so unhappy. There are 500 volunteers. I don't know who they are. I don't know where they are. I don't have a good record. The person who was here for 11 years before me was just fired. It's horrible. So I couldn't get her out of my head. And I called her about a week later, and I said, Nancy, you look like you're not having any fun. She said, what was your first clue? And I said, I'm going to make you an offer that you are more than welcome to refuse, but it seems to me that I have some expertise that you don't have. You've never been a volunteer director of a large agency before. I would be happy to be your coach. You can refuse, And if you agree, here's the caveat. I travel for a living, I name the hour, and you come to me. She said, is tomorrow good for you? 2 years we've been working together, and I will tell you that one of the results of her fabulous work, and it's been my pleasure to do this work, is that my husband has now become a volunteer at Jewish Family Service, so she's gained another fixler. But more importantly, their efforts around volunteer engagement were just identified as a critical strategic issue for the organization, as talent management of an abundant resource they never thought they had before. And so they've just written a 3-year strategic plan, and one of their top 4 priorities is talent management of volunteer resources. So that coaching, that time of saving a person from quitting because she was this far away, and it's been my pleasure, but I have control over my time. It's like the guy in Fort Collins who said on some research that we did, I'll gladly give your organization 52 hours in a year, but don't ask me to be there every week. So it's giving people that flexibility and control over time. And then the third one is a mentor. We underutilize mentorship in nonprofits. My belief is the better boards, best practice for boards and friends organization is that every new board member has a mentor who's a great rockin' good board member who can help get them in the culture faster. Every new volunteer has a mentor to help them in the culture faster. It's a great job. Volunteers love doing it. It takes very little training and it takes very little time. It helps to move cultural change faster. So these are the 3 things we want you to focus in as you think about the capacity building you want to do for you, whether you're a volunteer leader, a board chair, or a staff person. So what does it take to sort of use this information in structuring great position descriptions that will be easier to recruit and cultivate people to do? And there's some real magic here about position descriptions. So position descriptions really are the key. How many of you are utilizing position descriptions for volunteers right now? Okay. So if you're going to negotiate with me and create a powerful agreement, I need to see what you're thinking about. Or I've brought you a skill that never was on your radar, like Nancy at Jewish Family Service. We're going to write a position description together and negotiate a powerful agreement about what you're going to do and be held accountable for. Remember the control word? So most of our volunteers today have been employed or are employed. This is the world in which they live. They're not insulted by it. They're honored that you take the time to either do it with them or have it for them so that they can move forward. It's very important because we all worry about, well, it's going to get away from us. If you have a document that's clear for them and clear for you, it is the basis of how you support them, how you evaluate your success, how you move the program forward, and continuity. And when a volunteer leaves, it's a great opportunity to say, is this really what you were doing? So that you can continually upgrade it, because jobs change over time. So I want to talk about some elements of position description, since there are quite a few of you who are not using position description, and what's important in this new world. So titles matter. Don't let anybody tell you differently. So we sit in HR all the time, right? Titles don't really matter whether you're a library assistant 1 or 2. Horse hockey, right? If I'm a volunteer and I go to the grocery store, my church, my synagogue, my neighborhood party, and people say, what are you doing? That title communicates honor, respect, and invitation. So my husband, a new volunteer for the Jewish Family Service, is now a para-chaplain. He is being trained. It's 15 hours of intensive training to go and do friendly visiting to frail elderly. And he's learning about chaplaincy and outreach and prayer and whatever. So when he goes to cocktail parties and people say, well, Peter, you're retired. What are you doing? I am a para-chaplain for the Jewish Family Service. Feel the difference here from, Peter, what are you doing? I'm a friendly visitor. Do you see the difference? Honor, respect, dignity for them and for your organization. Really, what's a para-chaplain? What does that mean? I have 15 hours of training, and I'm accountable for a client load, and I have to go for in-service and group support, and I'm learning about hospice and all kinds of things. If you would have told me a year ago this would be what Peter Fischer's doing, I would have said, you're on drugs. So he is so excited. He comes home from training just buzzing. And where did that conversation start? Title. Titles matter. So when I work with churches and synagogues, I say, what do you call the people who put tushes in seats? Ushers. Okay? So if I'm an usher, what's my job? Tush, seats. Passing a plate, right? But if I'm a concierge, and my job is to create a warm and welcoming environment where people will have a spiritual experience, I'm so there. I'm not playing with you. If you call people a concierge and you expect that level of performance for them, that's what you get. If you say your job is to put tushes in seats, that's what you get. So titles really matter. So I love Mystery Shopper, Beverly. I love it because it's sort of like, wow, cool, what is that? And it happens, it's a very important job about measuring and holding the library accountable for customer service and performance. I'm a retired mystery shopper, so I know all about that. Not at a library. Okay, so key responsibilities. I want you to remember my ingredient issue. So here's what we do in position descriptions. We tell them everything. What to do, when to do it, where to do it, how to do it. That's policy, procedure, and training, and not generationally viable anymore, because we want to invite them to be able to have input in what we're doing. So there turns out there's a magic rule about key responsibilities, is that it's 3 or 4. If there are 10, what happens? Too many ingredients. If it's 1, how does that make people feel? Not very important. So it turns out that it matters that you're really clear. So if I am the concierge of your library, what are the key responsibilities that I have? I'm to create a warm and welcoming environment. I'm to provide information and resources. One more. I'm to increase the satisfaction of our consumers with what they receive in their relationship, increase their relationship with the library. That's enough. The rest is training. So you want to be really clear and cogent about 3 to 4 things, not 1, not 10. The next one, here we come, the I and O word again. It turns out what we fail to talk to volunteers about, because we never had to with Greatest Generation and Silent Generation volunteers, is you matter because, so what? So I come and I'm a concierge at the library, so what? So if we tell the person so what, they're more wanting to enlist and talk about it and grow your culture. And it happens that, as simple as this may sound, knowing the difference I make is a retention tool. So I'm not just coming in and moving people. I'm growing relationships for the library. Oh, and if there are relationships for the library, what's the so what? So that the library has a group of consumers who care about it, vote for it, support it beyond checking out a book. So it turns out that my job as a concierge of the library is I'm a cultivator of powerful relationships that will make a difference for my library's ability to survive and thrive. I am so there. And that's generationally appealing. For boomers and the generations that follow, we have to know that what we do has meaning and has an impact. And so we just don't talk about it enough. So if it's in the position description to begin with, we begin to make a difference in how we build that relationship and negotiate a result with a volunteer. So training and support. I'm afraid. I don't know the Dewey Decimal System. That was a joke. Come on, guys. That I don't know how to work in a library. We're going to help you understand all of the resources of the library. You're going to be a trained expert by the time we're done with you. Oh, okay, I can do that. So we have to overcome people's fear of the unknown, that just because they don't know our environment doesn't mean they can't be successful. So it matters to volunteers in their embracing of a yes, I will do this for you, is how will you support me, not supervise me, but support me and train me. So commitment, the more flexible you can make it, the better. So I had a client with a community center in an unnamed city, and to protect the guilty, and they said that they wanted volunteers to be the receptionists. They had laid off their receptionists, and they thought it would be so great to have volunteer receptionists. And I said, well, great. Tell me how many hours your reception desk is open. 6 a.m. to 10:30 p.m., 6.5 days a week. So, okay. Well, that means you need about 150 volunteers. And they went, oh, we don't want that. I said, well, they said, we just want 3 people. So I said, well, that sounds to me like you need 3 part-time people, because for volunteers to say yes, realistically, how much time are they going to give you? An average, if you're really lucky, 3 hours a week. Do the math. And they said, we think we'll hire a couple part-time people. So it matters what the commitment is. If you're asking somebody to be there, I see this all the time. We need a volunteer Monday through Friday. They should be there 20 hours a week. The opportunities for you to find a person who will say yes are fewer and fewer. That's why I really pushed back with you before about teams matter. It is not me carrying the weight of the world. I share that responsibility with trained and qualified and vetted other people. And that the commitment is, I have the freedom to make choices in my life. My daughter's having a baby. I'm going to go to Europe in September. And that I know that the world will continue without me. That's why substitutes are important. That's why there should always be job shares and teams to back you up. So you want a volunteer coordinator, that's great. Nobody's going to do it. If you say, be part of our volunteer team that's going to change the course and direction of our library, to be more receptive to engaging our community, 5 or 6 people will say yes. But they won't say yes to do it by themselves. So it turns out the commitment is really important. Qualifications. Here's the really cool thing, guys. That in a world where you have scarcity, you can't ever ask for experience. This is how we qualify volunteers. Are you ready? It's very scientific. Got a pulse? Works for me. And so when we do pulse taking, what happens? They become the volunteers from hell, right? And the ones that live long and large, and they tell stories about from Ought 2. There was a volunteer in Ought 2. You should have seen him. Okay? So it turns out that in this wonderful world where skills are in abundance, and it happens there are a lot of people in play who have skills, who have time. They're called unemployed people. Not retirees, unemployed people, that we can ask for someone with 3 to 5 years experience and a demonstrated portfolio. Isn't that cool? We don't have to be afraid to say, now every volunteer, do you want that? No, but you are looking for a couple of leads for a project on information, and you want demonstrated experience. Will people be offended by that? No, they want to use that experience. They want you for current reference. They're delighted to do that. So you can't do it for everybody, but don't be afraid to ask, because in your world, whether your library is one building or 30, chances are that in your world is everything you would ever need. We say this to congregations all the time. So you have 1,200 people in a congregation, members, if you're a Jewish congregation, members, or 1,200 people that are affiliated with you, that's 5,000 people. 1,200 families is 5,000 people. Chances are in 5,000 people, you have people with HR experience, IT experience, PR experience, whatever. So it's sort of moving that pendulum. And then finally, what's in it for me? To help your library. Nope. Okay? Yeah, that's a given. That's not what motivates people. My grandma of blessed memory, Grammy Ann, was a bookmobile volunteer for 20 years in Denver. She did not do it to help her library. She did it to help kids read. She did it to help open the library's doors to people who wouldn't actually come in. So, but that's not a benefit to me. That's an impact and an outcome. What's in it for me? Learn new skills. Use my professional skills. Opportunity for a professional network. Opportunity for a reference. opportunity for a letter to my employer. The best recognition that you can give people under the age of 64 is, Dear Joe Blow, Mary is a fabulous volunteer. You are so lucky to have her on your team. We wanted to thank you. How does Mary feel? Pretty darn good. What did it cost you? 44 cents. Okay? So it turns out that if I'm going to invest with you, I want a return on investment. I wanted to know what's in it for me. And you can't be afraid to say those things. Better library? That'll work for some people. I actually care about that. I'm in the library 3 times a week. For most people, it's, what am I going to get out of it? A new skill, a new friend, a new relationship, a new partner, a new colleague. So we need to describe that. So this is very different from where we began and where we've been, where I've been for 30 years as a volunteer engagement professional. But I will tell you, it is the basis for the conversations we're going to have until we leave tomorrow, which is, it's the basis for negotiation and agreements. It's the basis for accountability. If you don't have it in writing, it's up for interpretation. So mystery shopper is a great title. What's the impact and outcome, Beverly, do you think, of having a mystery shopper for your library?
For our library, it provides feedback about the quality of our customer service. It gives us information that will help us improve those services.
Okay, so it's feedback on how we're doing and information to help us do better and more. So I'm going to let Jen walk you through this quickly, tech leader job description.
Yep, this is the closing the loop of the work plan that you saw earlier, and it takes the spiral Jill just described and just puts it into some bullets for you. So key responsibilities and title are what's up there. The title of tech team leader does a couple of things. First, it clearly denotes leader. Now, you may have 2 or 3 tech team leaders sharing that job. It may look like a lot of different things, but it says this is the leader, and it's a little bit catchy. I still love web wizards, though. I just can't get it out of my head. I hope you keep it. But tech team is also something you could then call that team. The key responsibilities, you'll notice here, we're not saying how. We're not doing that prescriptive thing that we've warned you against. So we're saying, evaluate technology needs and identify opportunities. The pertinent question would be, okay, in an interview, which we're going to talk about tomorrow morning, you could say, Sally, if you were in this position, how would you evaluate our library's technology needs and identify some opportunities? That's an example of where you would get to. So you're not saying how. You're going to see in the interview and the vetting process what they're bringing to the table and know that this is the right person. Again, impact and outcome, those results we talked about. This is what will happen, change in knowledge, the self-sufficiency, the things you saw right from the work plan. So you'll notice by doing the work plan, you're actually writing parts of your position description. There's a nice efficiency here. Training and support that Jill mentioned, what is required? This is another place where we urge transparency. If I have to do a 4-hour orientation to your library technologies, which is perfectly reasonable, tell me. Tell me right away. Post it on Volunteer Match. Because if for any reason I can't do that, let me self-select out at the beginning and not waste your time. Right? Let me say, oh, that's not going to work. So here's the thing, though. 4-hour orientation to library technologies, I might think to myself, I wonder if I have to go to the library for that or if that's something I can do virtually. Right? It is technology after all. And I might ask that question. So when you write these down, think about where is the flexibility? Right? There's also the support of a staff liaison for biweekly meetings, phone, in person, troubleshooting as needed. So again, here you have the flexibility. It could be phone, it could be in person. Again, I travel a lot with my work. So if I wanted to do this and I knew that the meeting could sometimes be by phone, I'm now someone who can do this job. If it had to be in person, I might hesitate to even apply. So again, putting in the flexibility where you know you have it. Note, staff liaison is for the leader. So this is back to our earlier discussion. The staff role is about meeting and cultivating and supporting the leaders so that the leaders have the right education and the right message to go back to the team and execute for you. So, we have one last pilot. Marin County is going to come on up, share their position description with you. Yay. And of course, that means you get another tool. I know tonight you will be able to organize all of these samples and staple them together or clip them together so that you have them tomorrow. We've been handing you lots of paper. I am aware of the shuffle and that it got a little bit like, oh, what does she want us to have? No worries. We wanted you to have more rather than less, and you can sort and sift later. So with that, I turn it over to Scott Bauer from Marin County.
Thanks, thank you, Jennifer.
You betcha.
And Victoria and Nicole are passing out the job description as I speak. And it's a job description called Library Talent Scouts. And how many people here, somewhere in their mission statement for their library, says something about being a cultural or educational center of the community? That's one of the things our mission statement says. And so we were sort of putting together ideas and brainstorming and said, well, what does that really mean if we're the cultural center or the educational center for our community? And of course, it meant what we always have been doing in terms of providing information services, books, periodicals people can read to check out, helping children, you know, with their homework assignments. But it also means that it meant something more to us in terms of how do we bring the community in and be part of the educational and cultural center for the entire community. And so we thought, well, you know, maybe this is a way to find out who in our community has these talents and these skills and this knowledge, and wouldn't it be great if they could share it with the rest of the community, and maybe the library can essentially be the conduit for that sharing, provide the forum for it. And what would that mean? What would that look like? And so we said, well, what about somebody who would actually go out there and knows their neighbors and knows what their skills are and might have a friend who's like a technologist at, Autodesk in our community, or might know a scientist at one of the biotech startups that we have. Or on the other hand, maybe just knows somebody who's really a great quilter and would love to, you know, teach people how to do quilting. And so that was the basic sort of seed for what the Library Talent Scout idea was. Somebody who could go out in the community, could talk to their friends, could make the contacts, could say, you know, I bet you this is something the library could host and that somebody else in our community might be interested in. And that, from the library's point of view, is a great thing in terms of it's a way for us to make that connection, because we all know programming is a great form of outreach. And it's also a way to take us sort of out of the middle and bring in the volunteers to help us provide that resource and that ideas for our community. So you heard Jill and Jennifer talk a little bit about how the work plan feeds into this job descriptions, and I can tell you that, when we first started working on this, what do we need a work plan for? We'll just go right for the job description because, hey, you know, we know what we want. Well, I didn't actually send them the first or second of those job descriptions because basically they stank. They were all over the place, they were meandering, they didn't really have any focus whatsoever. One of the great things about the work plan and about the job description is it helps you to focus, to keep that concentration, to say, how does this really relate to our mission and to the vision that we have for our communities? So the position overview, you know, do you have an eye for talent? Well, that's part of our vision of, you know, bringing people into the library and looking out for those opportunities there. Those key responsibilities, a lot of them come out of those actions that we developed for the plan. The training and support provided, well, take a look at those resources that you're providing, and you can just bring them right in. The benefits, you know, your initial impacts, your sustained outcomes, and going back around, even back to the original vision. These are things that can appeal to people as, you know, I would really feel good if I could, you know, provide this sort of information to our community or this sort of cultural event. And I know I'm helping my neighbors who, you know, they always talking about how much they enjoy doing this. So that's the sort of things we were looking at as we put this description together. And the other thing I'd like to say is one of the things I personally had to overcome, which maybe it's an occupational hazard, I don't know, is perfectionism. This is not perfect. It doesn't have to be perfect. Get it out there so people can look at it. When they come in and you talk with them in the interviews, start making notes, because they'll tell you what isn't working for them and what will make it better. It's an ongoing process. It's not an end point. It's to step along the journey. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Scott. Scott, that was terrific. So here is a program, the Talent Scouts. It's all about that personal ask that we talked about before. Before we go any further, oh, and Scott, I should tell you, I'm going to call you out, Jennifer, that I was sitting over there out of the camera way listening to you, and I saw Jennifer Baker pick up your lovely position description. And please understand, the pilots didn't see each other's materials before today either. And she took a look at it, and she said, oh, I am so stealing that. Yep, calling you out. And I say, go too. So for anyone who would like someone to go out and say, hey, do you have an eye for talent? What a wonderful opening line that they've come up with in Marin County, and I absolutely urge you to steal it all over California. Do you have an eye for talent? Do you want to help the library? Hey, why not? So before we go any further, I want to take a moment and thank all of the pilots who have spoken thus far. You demonstrate this work in ways that we simply cannot by talking about it in theory. You were, to a person, eloquent, wonderful. We are so grateful to have worked with you and so thankful that you were willing to stand up, speak in public, which not everyone will do, share your work products so generously with the entire statewide team here in front of me. And so I just want to take a moment and just have a big round of applause for all of you. You are truly awesome, Jill.
Thank you. We are humbled by your fabulous work. So what a day we've had. And I don't know about you, but I need to process this a little bit. And I think you need to process this with your team. So we're going to give you about 10 minutes to just sit with it and think about what you need to be focused on for tomorrow when we do our applied learning. You'll have a chance to use a whole session to begin your plan and your position descriptions. I just want you to have a chance with your team, because we don't want you to sit with your team tonight at dinner, hint, 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 so we can really grow our community, is just to percolate a bit. So 10 minutes, conversation, sit with it, think about what your aha moments were, and then we'll do a little bit of sharing. I'd like to share some of your conversation with us. If I understand what you're saying, matching your community and your skills with your local library, and so the Talent Scout thing really resonated with you all, about the blending of what people have to offer and what you need, and making that a I'm putting words in your mouth, but I think the idea of the library as a convener is a really important concept and an underutilized concept for libraries as a convener in community. And this idea that Marin did so beautifully about talent scouting is, you know, you have relationships that are undercapitalized, underutilized in the space in which you are. And if you really maximize all those relationships, you'd be able to survive a little bit better, whatever the economic situation. So great. What else bubbled up? So yeah. They have a lunch at the library program, and what a great opportunity, particularly with their audience, which happens to be more seasoned older adults, what we typically called seniors, but more seasoned older adults around this new language to help get them moving and be great with friends groups. So that's a great idea. What else bubbled up over here?
Brainstorming about something, and something came up about your ask kind of idea that you guys got. And we have a lot of computer users who are in the library on a regular basis. And why can't we ask them that, even though they're already there, to help other people who don't know how to get email, who don't know how to print, who don't know how to do this, and maybe we can ask them when they're there sometimes for 2 or 3 hours or 3 days a week.
My Auntie Renee, who is 78 years old and has been my mother's best friend. She's not really my aunt, but she's been my mother's best friend for 54 years. Didn't own a computer until a year ago because she went to her library every day. Auntie Renee is a retired debate coach and a high school teacher, and all of her skills went underused. So she was in the Cobell Library in Inglewood, in Littleton, Colorado, every day for 5 years and was underutilized. So you don't know what's lurking there. So to Dara's point is that there are all these fabulous, there's these people that are coming in every day who are using your computer and you don't know who they are. And would they be willing to help a younger person, an older person, because they're obviously computer literate, in helping? So there's an underutilized resource and a relationship for you to build that's there, some of them, every day. Other thoughts that came up? So, Dave, a lovely point. So if we go too small, we're sort of doing it already, and their tendency is to go with what we know. Well, we'll just tell volunteers what to do, and they'll do it. It's not the change we're looking for after these 2 days. And if we go too big, then there's going to be all kinds of pushback. Experiment, pilot. I'm sorry, Carrie, what was the terminology
again? Demonstration.
Demonstration project. So demonstration project says it could fail, it could succeed, and I don't have to worry about it in my world. So I think you can scale higher when you're experimenting. And people will go, well, that's no risk to me because it's just a demonstration project. So don't be afraid to put, I say, go, be bold, be audacious. Because you're in libraries that are in this traditional environment, here's the thing I haven't really said today. If you're not bold and you're not audacious, this moment, this glorious moment, where we have this combination of the service agenda, the economy, and more library users will pass us by. It will never come again. It's the perfect storm. One more. Yes.
Well, I thought it would be really cool to be able to match volunteers to their interests, their natural interests. And so to have kind of like a starting point where there were all these, like, I'm interested in gardening, I'm interested in education, and that the volunteer then could be slotted to possible volunteer opportunities, but also workshops in the library that would support them.
So creating sort of, I'm going to put little words in your mouth, so bear with me, and if I'm just off, just slap me. But you're talking about a skills bank. So the opportunity to create a skills bank for the people who are already in your world and then doing some matching. I had the privilege of hearing Edgar Kahn this week. Does anybody know who he is? He wrote a wonderful book called No Throwaway People, and he invented time banking. So some of your communities have time banking, timebanking.org. It's the most gorgeous thing. It's about, I'm in an intentional community, and I can, every hour has the same value, and I can donate hours as an attorney, as a handyman, visiting people, cooking a meal, and then when I am a person of need, I could pull out an hour. Is that gorgeous? It's gorgeous. So I'm not sure, I struggled because I just heard this at the Lutheran Services in America conference this week. Was it library applicable? And I'm not sure that it is, but certainly applicable in your communities. Think about senior centers, brilliant. However, the idea that your skills banking, that you create a skills bank to draw from so that you don't have to say, well, how would we use volunteers? We can go to the software to do that. So Blackbaud, many of you use Razor's Edge, has this capability.